Hi folks, a two subject video today. Wyntercon, what happened, and also prepping. And part of Wyntercon and the experiences also feeds into the prepping side. Now, I have spoken in a video a few years ago about the issue of prepping here and what I've done and the considerations at the time, but I'm going to go through it again. Even though not that much sort of has changed, really-ish. We'll start off with Wyntercon and the convention. You know how you prepare for something, and you always forget something, no matter what you do. And this time around, I forgot my poppy. I've been wearing it all last week, took it off, put it one side, ready to put on what I changed into to go to Eastbourne, and left it on the side. Great. But I was very nervous, and it was quite an experience. I mean, I pretty much knew that there was no way that I was going to even break even. The majority of the books that I ordered for stock came back with me, but met new people. I mean, there was about four tables. I was one of a group of four tables. There was a few further on, but we all hit it off. And our particular three tables, oh boy, did we have a good laugh. And although it was my first time, one, yeah, I think he said he's been like at 200 tables or something. He really attends a lot of conventions and things, and even down to farmers markets, pardon me, to sell his books. And, you know, tips got handed out. I've learned an awful lot. And one of the other things that I've learned is, previously, I never really gave a thought to the age of my audience, because selling on the internet, you know, you're pretty much guaranteed that whoever's doing that, they've got to have a credit card. So you've got a sort of an age check in there, but things are changing. And one of the people that came out to buy Checkmate was a father and son. And that made me think, so I'm reviewing things over that, through that experience. If you're on the other channels and you're following me, particularly on book likes, I pretty much put summarized a chunk of my experiences, and a few other people have asked questions and given their own experiences as well. So there's a few bits and pieces on there. I'm not going to cover everything in this video, jeepers. The experience of Wyntercon, I think they've most of it is sussed. They've obviously done these a few times before. It's growing, and I think some odd minor stuff caught them out. They actually made these for us for the tables, so it pretty much came in to those, which is pretty cool. I also saw one of my heroes who was there, Norman Lovett, aka Holly, from Red Dwarf, and all the other things that he does most of his time now as a stand-up comedian. There's a few small stories, but Wyntercon actually did pretty good on the social side of things. I think most of the arrangement was pretty good. There were a few oddities. Pardon me, it's just getting to that stage. And they even pushed all the rest of it, all the rest of us, and the artists. There was a section for all the artists who were there, local, and the rest of it. Even I'm in there for the writing section. So even though this was like my first ever time attending any convention anywhere, I still got pushed, promoted. which is quite stunning, really. They took care of everyone. Top of the bill was Virginia Hay, and we were actually setting up during before they opened the doors, and this one woman came over to talk, and it was obviously by the looks of her that she was, the way she was dressed and made up, that she was making her living from her image and her whatever. And it wasn't after she left until my friend, who was a film buff, suddenly the penny dropped, and we were talking with Caroline Monroe, who was pretty much local, and was sharing some stories with some of us. And our three tables really hit it off. I mean, it was stressful. My nerves, you know, talking with the general public, I just couldn't relax. I was on edge for the entire 2 days. Learned a lot. And it's what you learn that feeds into the next time. It's pretty much called the 7 P's. Anyone in the army will know what the 7 P's are. It's about being prepared, and I've got knowledge is the more knowledge you have, the better off you are, pretty much. The more able you are to handle things, handle situations. It's all down pretty much to what kind of situations you're handling. I'll put a link in the hoo-ha bar to one prepper, as they're known, Roach, Armored Cockroach, and one of his videos. He does a lot of videos, and pretty much on the preparedness side. There is a prepper community, but at the end of the day, like Roach says, we're all preppers. It's all a matter of what you're prepping for and what your priorities are and what you think you are at risk of. How many of us save for a rainy day? That was one of the examples that he gave. And a lot of gaining the experience, I'll now be better prepared for the next convention because I'll know what risks I'm facing. I've learned quite a bit, and some of what I've learned has already been enacted to make things better from the author side of things. Book selling, and I never really thought of the younger generation reading anything that I wrote until I hit the Wyntercon experience. So I've got to rethink things that I'm doing. Drawing lines, calculating risk. I covered some of this stuff before. Are the kind of things that I prepare for. I think we're pretty much lucky here, in that our risks mostly are natural events. Like losing power is a big one. I think some people don't realise that if we're not on gas, but some people don't realise that if you lose electricity on a modern system, you also lose the gas. Because they're driven by microprocessors. So even if you lose the power but you've still got gas, you can't run the gas system, so you're still going to be out of hot water. Those sorts of things. If we lose power, we lose heat, we lose hot water, we lose lighting. And so I've got a couple of these bivy sacks, which are designed to reflect our heat back into us. There are other techniques like the flower pot technique, two flower pots on top of each other, and four tea lights. You know, tea lights are quite cheap, and it generates a sort of a radiating heat function. It's quite cool, and if you look at it, look at that. I think they're called flower pot heaters or something. Yeah, they're pretty cool. In an emergency, you can do that sort of thing. Because a lot of this prepping isn't so much a case of disaster strikes, zombies attack, so you abandon your home and go into the wilderness to escape whatever nasty is attacking. It's a case of being able to survive the oddities that happen at home, really. I think the worst that could strike us, I mean, where we are, flood. If we flood, pretty much all of Sussex is in trouble. There aren't any trees in the vicinity, so we're not going to get hit by a falling tree, but wind could do damage to the house itself. It could do damage to the roof if it ever got hot fast enough. You never know when sinkholes are going to open up. They've caught everyone pretty much off guard when they've happened, and they've caused minor chaos, especially on roads and the rest of it. I think this is one of the things that's got people pretty much scared of fracking. Whereas in places like the US, where they've done a lot of this fracking to release things, they've got the space where they can do it, and it doesn't. They can do that far away from populated areas. With us, we haven't really got that kind of option. So I think we're more at risk of natural things happening, lightning strikes, those sorts of things, power loss, and there's other stuff. I mean, I don't think that we'd be able to install a generator here. I think that the net result, the noise it would generate, would pretty much hack off all the neighbours here. You know, I have seen some of the more modern, reasonable cost versions of generators, and you know, it's an expense really that delivers power, and I've got to think how long would we be without power for. We've obviously got portable stoves, enough gas to last a couple of weeks, I think. And even if that fails, I've then got methane burner. If something strikes the roof of the house and we're in trouble, I do have a canvas I can set us up in the back garden if we absolutely have to. It's that sort of thing. I haven't put that much money behind it. The other thing is lighting. If we lose power, we lose lighting. But I've mixed in the emergency lighting with other lighting. I mean, I've got UPSs here for the computers, and rather than attempt to, over the last few years, I've invested in power efficient systems, so that not only am I not using that much power off the grid, and it's costing less, I'm also generating less heat out of it. So I'm not having to install things like air conditioning to try and keep the temperatures down. Those sorts of decisions. And I've actually thrown some ideas at the UPS designers to actually have a socket which is its normal position is off, and when a power cut happens, it comes on. So you could have something like a table lamp, a couple of table lamps hooked up to these in various places. And it doesn't even have to be mains. If you have something which is fed directly from the battery, if you have specific, if you do have mains lamps, then this power socket could come on, because you're dealing with the UPS anyway, and thus use that to power a desk lamp. So if everything went dark, some lighting, some strategically placed lighting, could come on. And also I've got these. I'm currently lit by a light which is it's a base which is plugged into the mains via a transformer, and the neck is actually goes up, and that the head unit itself, if I just turn this off and unplug it from here to show you, the head itself is reasonably thin, but there's actually a battery in here running LEDs, and this itself on first stage low power can run for about 8 hours on its own. So if the power gets lost here, I'm not scrabbling around to try and find the emergency lighting. It's already here and able to be used. In fact, if I've got this on at the time I lose power, this stays running. I've just got to turn this off and put it back on its stand, otherwise it doesn't like it if it's put on while it's already under power. But things change in the world. I don't think we are at risk of social meltdown. There have been isolated riots throughout our history, but I think with the amount of police force and army military that we've got, any riots would be localized. I mean, those riots have caused an awful lot of damage, but it has been local. I think we're at more risk of Black Monday or Black Friday, whatever it is, that Nazi shopping day, than we are of social meltdown. Things change in the world rapidly, and I've pretty much concluded that, I mean, when we first moved in here about 8 years ago, the Russians were threatening to turn off oil, which was one of the reasons which fed in to the decisions that I made as to what we did with supply, as to whether we actually installed, we had options. We could have gone gas and had a gas tank at the back. We could have done the same with oil, had an oil tank and gone for oil heating. But the price of oil was rising quite rapidly, and gas was rising quite rapidly as well. And the Russians were threatening to turn off the pipes. But now we're in a completely different situation 8 years down the line. The Americas have got a lot of oil. The price of oil has crashed. The world is changing. And if I put a lot of money behind prepping for a certain circumstance, the whole ball game could change in just a few years. Not only that, health and ability as well. Like cars, for example. I mean, I had the Ford Escort, but it had reached the point where I was to keep it on the road. I don't have the facilities to maintain it. I mean, even if I had a spare engine, you know, there would be a point in my health where I would not be able to do the maintenance. So even if I put all the effort behind having all the spare parts, yada yada yada, there would be a point where it would just become a waste of money because it would be useless to me. But also the modern car, I mean, it's more reliable, it's costing me less in the here and now, and it will cost me less in the years to come. But even if I had a garage, the space and the tools, the electronic systems in that means that there's no way that I personally could maintain it. You know, it's pretty much the stage where it's a kind of technology where home tinkering is just impossible. You can do so many things, but that's it. I went out there a couple of days ago to check the nuts. And, you know, I went out there with the old bar and the socket, and took the covers off and thought, what the heck is that? No chance. I can't do it. Even the nuts are just nuts. Crazy. So there are some things which I can't prepare for. We have had cases in the UK where we've had floods. That's one thing that you've just got to be aware of. It's one of those decisions that you've got to take into account when you buy the property that you're buying. How likely are you, how open are you to flood, wind, falling trees? Those are the kinds of risks that you've got to take into account when you buy the property, and you've got to be happy with at the time that you do that. But we have had, and here we've suffered it, we've had like a case of 2 or 3 days where you're snowed in. The roads around here are very windy, they're very up and down, so when the snow hits they get slippy, and unless you've got a four-wheel drive, you wouldn't want to risk your neck, you know. But the cost of running a four-wheel drive against the impact of being out of it for a few days, you know, that's the kind of no chance. I mean, fortunately we have the internet and I can work from home, so there's no real financial impact. But there were some days where if you couldn't get into work, or you didn't make an effort to get into work, then you weren't paid, even though you were snowed in. We've also faced situations where the pipes have burst and we've lost water pressure, so we've had no water for a few days. We haven't reached the case where we've had to go out for standpipes, because pretty much they've got better at recovering from those sorts of failures. And when we first moved in, when we were having frequent power cuts, we're now having less power cuts than we've ever had. But in terms of the water side of things, they've now changed the pipework, so the risk of being without water is less than it was before. And in terms of solar energy, the cost of putting solar energy in against the benefit of selling energy back to the grid is not going to pay for itself. And there's also risk involved when you start dabbling with that kind of electrics. Not only are you putting the building structure under extra strain that it wasn't designed for, you're also dealing with the risk that the electronics themselves could actually cause a fire. So everything's got its good and bad points, and those are the things you've got to sort of weigh up. I think the issues with Greece and other things that have been seen happening mean that I don't think that we'd ever be facing financial meltdown in this country. There is a deficit, and I think that the governments have had sufficient reason to now sort out all this corporate money shifting that's going on, and tax evasion, by shifting money to a different location. And I think that it's not easy for them to tackle, because the way that the money is being moved, it's being moved legitimately within the existing rule system. And because the rules are only set by individual countries, when you're dealing with an international situation, trying to get agreement between the countries is very difficult, particularly when one of the countries is the one that's receiving all the tax, because that's where all the money is being shifted to in order for the company to pay tax on. So it does make it very difficult. But I think the impetus is there. I think it's going to be a few more years before we see a solution. But likewise, I think that's going to happen in a few years, and that is going to solve a degree of the money worries for the financial meltdown, and I think we'll see the countries pick back up again and be able to afford the social the social side of things, which will hopefully save us from collapse, because I don't think we would collapse. I mean, Greece hasn't been allowed to collapse because the impact on the other countries has been so great, would have been so great, that they had a lot invested in not letting Greece collapse. And I think that would probably be the same with the UK. We also have another few backstops by which, if we failed politically, if our political system fails, we have a backstop in the Queen, who can, the monarch who can take the reins, still be a force of authority and representation on the world stage. So I think we've got adequate backup there. It's all a matter of what you're preparing for. But I think there's something else to be done and worthwhile on the bushcraft side of things and the survival technique side of things, which is that the ability to handle any disaster is knowledge. And when you've got knowledge in being able to handle things and confidence in your being, in your ability to handle things that are out of the ordinary, it then boosts your own self-confidence, so when something else hits, you've got confidence to overcome it, even though you're not, you know, it helps your confidence generally. And also getting out and practicing something like bushcraft gets you away, gets you out of the house, change your four walls, gets away from the internet, gets away from the mobile phone ish and you're doing stuff in with nature, and you're meeting other people and talking about other things, and you know, it gets you a bit of a break. I think it's good for the mental health as well as whatever you're learning. You know, at the end of the day, practicing things like it's no good having something like a paraffin burner or some of these other burners and equipment for emergency if you don't get the practice in using them. You know, it's all a case of buying the equipment, but it's absolutely useless if you can't use it. I don't think that we're ever likely to see a breakout of I don't think we're likely to see a catastrophic breakout of anything like bird flu or Ebola here. I think it would be contained relatively quickly. It wouldn't do the because of our structure, our social structure, and the services that we've got, we wouldn't see the kind of effect that it's had in Africa. The emergency services are under pressure, no doubt about that, not only from funding, but also some of the things that are being undertaken. I mean, there are several books. I mean, things have reached, not only recently, but even up to a decade ago, things in the emergency services were such that people were blogging about them. The anonymity of the internet gave some people the courage to come forward and tell us what was actually going on, and even in some cases write books. And in some cases, the population really is its own worst enemy, you know. But I don't think the emergency services will ever be allowed to fail. Any government which did that would pretty much face a lot of people banging the doors down. And again, we have another backstop. Say what you like about the House of Lords, but it is able to prevent, it's our version of Congress, basically, able to stop or amend legislation that's going through, to prevent a railroad of some things. Like, there have been legislations that have been railroaded through, regardless, and other things which have been snuck under the radar. Particularly in the name of censorship and social control. I do think that I personally am more at risk of something politically happening. And, you know, there are some stunning things that have happened to people. They've got tied up in all sorts of situations that aren't of their own making, and it's cost them all their money, it's cost them their home, turned their lives upside down. And I think that we are more at risk of something like that happening than facing an outbreak of Ebola, bird flu, or anything like that, on an individual basis. And I have to admit, faced with something like that, you know, survival skills aren't going to get you very far in those kinds of situations. Nuclear attack, I don't know. I mean, there was one very solid point made by the Labour conference, which was that everybody's going on and on and on about Trident, keep it, scrap it, keep it, scrap it, it's useless, it's costing us a fortune, yada yada yada. And the ultimate question is that rather than look at Trident, we need to be stepping back and looking at what is needed to deliver deliver security in the modern world. Are we still looking at nuclear deterrent, or are we looking at some other technology to keep us safe? And trust to that, as we have trusted to Trident in the past, because, you know, rather than the issue specifically about Trident, it's involving taking a step back and looking at what we actually need to provide the security these days, because stuff moves on at such a pace. And then whether Trident forms a part of that re-envisaged strategy is another question. there's a lot going on. But I am always revisiting, or rather, I'm watching the news, and things that I see are affecting and changing my plans on an ongoing basis as to what risks I really could be facing and what, if anything, I should do about them. It's an ongoing situation, and and I think we're all doing that. What risks are we facing? What are our needs? And how best to meet them in the everyday. Our needs are best, our needs are a roof over our heads, potentially a nice car, food, definitely, of varying standards, the things that make our lives a life worth living. You know, these are the kinds of things that are actually part of everyday decisions. And a lot of the stuff that Armored Cockroach is actually saying does actually make sense. It's a long discussion, really, as to what we think is a real risk of actually happening. And what do we actually want to do about them? Because in some cases, it's a case of, you know, if a nuclear bomb is coming our way, I'd rather be at ground zero than try and outrun nuclear radiation, thank you very much. Yeah. There are those sorts of decisions. And, you know, some people are recognizing risks that others of us haven't even thought of. I know one risk, which is that if I don't get to bed and get some sleep, then I'm not going to get up in time for work tomorrow. But one of the things that I know I spend time with the Ramblers, which has been curtailed really because of all the commuting I'm doing and the book writing. But when I finally have some of that under control and I'm not commuting as much, I want to return to rambling and I want to learn a bit of bushcraft. Because not only is it learning something new and increasing my own confidence in my self-reliance and my ability to handle situations that come, but also a change of four walls and meeting other people and hearing other viewpoints and, you know, being part of another community. So there's much more to this than meets the eye. Yes, there are preppers who are really far out there, who have like stockpiled food for years on end, and really gone out on a limb, you know, hoarded stuff, and you know that stuff's going to go out of date, you know. What kind of life is it to live a life which is always assuming and being prepared for the worst that's going to happen? When actually the worst is going to happen could actually be quite different to what you think. I think it's better to just face some everyday realities. I mean, at the worst, we would lose power here for 2 days. It's happened. We've lost power. The winds took out a lot of lines, but it wasn't long before there was a low power generator hooked up to the lines in various locations around this area. It wasn't enough power to allow us to like run an oven to cook the dinner, but it allowed everyone to have the lights on and boil a kettle, and the rest of it we could handle on the stoves, and we always had enough heat. But one of those other things, that there are tips and tricks. I'm not sure if I've mentioned this, but if you have the ability, if you're in rented accommodation, you wouldn't be able to do this, or maybe not, depending on your lease. But one of the tricks is like four tea lights. Then you have two pots, plant pots, one on top of the other, different sizes, and the as long as you've got you have the tea lights on a tray, they heat the air, which then heats the air around the other pot, and because you've got the pots there, they create convection, and it heats the whole room. And the tea lights are relatively inexpensive. If you can see it, it's probably plant pot heater or something like that. You know, those sorts of things don't cost much, and you can be, you know, you can use the plant pots, have them out on display, but you know, when the worst happens and you do lose power, you know, sorry, Mr. Begonia, you're going to have to die. I need the pot. Or I die, you know. There are things which aren't lunacy. You know, there are things which are common sense, and there are things that you can do which won't cost the earth. And are relatively handy to have around. They're good ideas. Without being completely otherworldly, oh, good grief, we're going to get invaded by zombies and set yourself up an underground bunker and all that jazz. So, I'm tired. My voice is failing me. My eyelids are failing me. And I'll see you on the next video, guys.
Yeah.
But I came back with a lot of stock. Anyone want to buy a book? Take care. Bye for now.